أعوذ بالله من الشيطان اللعين الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الحمد لله الذي لا يبلغ مدحته القائلون ولا يحصي نعمه العادون ولا يؤدي حقه المجتهدون الذي بعد فلا يرى وقرب فشهد النجوى تبارك وتعالى والصلاة والسلام على سيد الأنبياء وخاتم المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين سيدنا ونبينا بالقاسم محمد اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعلى أهل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد واللانة الدائمة الباقي لأعدائهم ومنكر فضائلهم وغاصب حقوقهم من الآن إلى قيام يوم الدين أما بعد فقد قال الله سبحانه وتعالى في كتابه الكريم إن الذين يغضون الله ورسوله لعنهم الله في الدنيا والآخرة وعد لهم عذابا مهينا صلوات Tonight we have gathered to commemorate the 30th of the Shahadat of Imam Hussein ibn Ali alayhi salatu wasalam, and especially to remember his daughter, the four-year-old daughter Sakina or Ruqayya. Different, she is known by different names among different Shia communities. And I would like to basically tonight talk about this concept of love and hatred, or like and dislike in the matters of our faith. Especially discuss the concept of la'anat. When we look at the concepts like hub and bughd, love and hatred, or like and dislike, these are two natural emotions in human beings created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself. Love is easy to understand, but hatred is not that easy to understand. And this is where we have to realize whether we are talking about love or hatred, you know, whether it is right or wrong, this all depends on their basis. What is the basis of loving something, and what is the basis of hating or disliking something? In Islam, the basis of hub and bughd, love and dislike, is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To love Allah and whatever brings you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is praiseworthy. And similarly, to dislike whatever is disliked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is praiseworthy also. And this is where we have to realize when we talk about dislike, it could be an ideology, it could be a person, or it could be an item. Anything which takes us away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that becomes the object of our dislike and our bughd. Imam Ja'far al-Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, was one asked about the relationship of love and hatred to our faith, to the deen. And he very powerfully, in a very short sentence, he says, halil iman illa al-hubb wal-bughd? Is faith other than love and hatred? Means these elements are there, which is part of defining our faith. And then he recited ayat number 7 of chapter 49, Surah Al-Hujarat, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَكِنَّ اللَّهَ حَبَّبَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْإِيمَانُ وَزَيَّنُهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. That verily Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it comes to iman and faith, He has made it a beloved element, an element to be loved by you. وَزَيَّنُهُ فِي قُلُوبِكُمْ. And he has made the iman and faith as a decor for your heart. وَكَرَّهَ إِلَيْكُمُ الْكُفْرُ وَالْفُسُوقَ وَالْعِصْيَانِ. And Allah has disliked for you, has created this dislike in you for kufr, you know, this is disbelief, and fusuq, basically committing sins openly, and usiyan means disobeying Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So these elements of hub and bughd, you know, to like and dislike, these are basically elements which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created within us. For example, if we would like to, you know, examine ourselves and see whether at what level of goodness are we? Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salatu wa salam says, إِذَا أَرَدْتَ أَن تَعْلَمْ أَنَّ فِيكَ خَيْرًا. If you want to know whether there is goodness and khayr in you, then do the following. He says, فَانْظُرْ إِلَىٰ قَلْبِكَ. Look at your heart. فَإِنْ كَانَ يُحِبُّ أَهْلَ طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ وَيُبْغِضُ أَهْلَ مَعْصِيَةِ اللَّهِ فَفِيكَ خَيْرٌ وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّكَ. Look at your heart and see that whether you like the people who are obedient to Allah and you dislike those who are disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then this should be the sign that there is goodness in you and Allah loves you. وَإِنْ كَانَ يُبْغِضُ أَهْلَ طَاعَةِ اللَّهِ. But if your heart dislikes those who obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَيُحِبُّ أَهْلَ مَعْصِيَةِ اللَّهِ, and your heart loves those who are disobedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, فَفِيكَ شَرٌ, then there is evil in you. وَاللَّهُ يُبْغِضُكَ, and Allah doesn't like you. وَالْمَرْءُ مَعَ مَنْ أَحَبَّ, and a person is known by those whom he loves. And so this issue of hub and bughz, love and hatred, like and dislike, this is part of our faith. This becomes a measure of whether we are on the right path or not. Now when we talk about this issue of hub and bughz, love and hatred, or like and dislike, these are the matters of, you know, that they reside in our heart. These are the emotions and the feelings which are within us. However, when we talk about these emotions and these feelings, they cannot be confined to our hearts. These emotions should also be expressed. And when we talk about expression here, we are talking about to express our like and dislike verbally. Look at Surah Al-Ahzab, Surah number 33, ayat 56 and 57. Verses 56 and 57. And then this is where you will see the expression of what is known as hub and bughz. In ayat number 56, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ وَمَلَائِكَتُهُ يُصَلُّونَ عَلَى النَّبِيِّ يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا صَلُّوا عَلَيْهِ وَسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. The ayat means, verily Allah and His messengers send blessings upon the Prophet. And so you, O who believe, send blessings upon him and salute him in the best of manners. So those who love the Prophet and his family, they join Allah and his angels in expressing their love by doing salawat. So salawat is an expression of our love for the Prophet and his family for the sake of the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next ayat is the opposite. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يُؤْذُونَ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ. Those who hurt Allah and His Messenger, لَعَنَهُمُ اللَّهُ فِي الدُّنْيَا وَالْآخِرَةِ. Allah invokes the la'nat on them in this world and the hereafter. وَعَدَّ لَهُمْ عَذَابًا مُهِينًا. And He has prepared a humiliating punishment for them. La'nat here, and I'll explain the meaning later on. La'nat here is expression of dislike for those who hurt the Prophet and his family. So salawat and la'nat are actually two sides of the same coin. One reflects the expression of love and the other, you know, reflects the expression of dislike. One is hub and the other one is bughd. The love for the Prophet and his family is actually linked to the love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the dislike of those who hurt the Prophet and his family is linked to the dislike for those who take you away from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. People don't have any problem with this expression of love for the Prophet and his family. But there are some who have problem with the expression of dislike for those who hurt the Prophet and his family. This issue of expression of our dislike for those who hurt the Prophet and his family has become a recent controversy in Pakistan during the Muharram because of Ziyarat-e-Ashura, which was recited publicly in one of the Julus on the day of Ashura. Not only in the views of the Wahhabis and the Salafi groups it became a controversy, but also a fringe element within the Shias who have expressed their opposition to the issue of La'anat. And this is the reason that tonight I would like to talk about this issue of La'anat as clearly and as precisely as I can. Salawat parne ek baar. Salawat. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. When we talk about this expression of dislike for something in the matter of religion, this can take two forms. One is known as sabb. Sabb means to vilify or defame someone by using offensive or abusive words or by using swear words. This is obviously not allowed in Islam. I will just be very brief here. Two proof for that this is not allowed. Number one, the Quran. Chapter 6, ayat number 108. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and we are talking about the word sabb. Sabb means, you know, to use offensive or abusive words, swear words. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلَا تَسُبُّ الَّذِينَ يَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ فَيَسُبُّ اللَّهَ عَدْوًا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ. Do not verbally abuse those whom they call upon in their prayers besides Allah, in case they abuse Allah in revenge without knowledge. So we are talking about the idol worshippers here. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, yes, idol worshipping is wrong. You have to combat that. You have to fight against it. But don't use abusive words against their idols, because if you do that, in return, the idol worshippers will use abusive words for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Another example that we have is from Amir al-Mu'mineen in the Battle of Siffin. He heard that some of his companions were hurling abusive words towards the Syrian forces. So he called them and he basically advised them. He says, إِنِّي أَكْرَهُ لَكُمْ أَن تَكُونُوا سَبَّابِينَ. I dislike that you be the abuser in your speech. And then, it doesn't say it means, you know, the others are fine. No, he goes on to say, but if you describe their deeds and recount their situations, that would be a better mode of speaking and a more convincing way of arguing. This is in Nahj al-Balagha, Sermon 204. So when we look at this issue of sab and use of swear words against others, this is not allowed. However, it doesn't mean that others are okay and everybody is going to go to Jannah, even if they fought against Ali. No. Amir al-Mu'minin is very clear that don't use abusive words, but you are allowed to describe the opponent's deeds and expose their situation, but in a civil manner, without using swear words. So this is the first mode of expression of dislike, by using sab and abusive words. This is not allowed. This brings us to the second mode of expressing dislike for those who are wrong in our faith. And this is known as la'an or la'anat. La'anat is different from swear words and sab. There are two different words here. Sab, which was even forbidden in the Quran. And then now we are talking about la'an and la'anat. Although the translation of la'anat is curse in English, but it doesn't mean swear words or abusive words. It has a very specific meaning, and I would like you to pay attention to this very clearly. When we talk about the word la'an or la'anat, there is a very specific meaning. It means a prayer to deprive someone from God's mercy. When the la'anat is invoked by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it's not a prayer. It is actually a declaration by him that he is depriving the person from his mercy. But when the la'anat is invoked by a human being, then it means that he is praying that may Allah deprive so-and-so from his mercy. And so when we talk about la'an and la'ana, this is actually a prayer. And in English, a proper word for that, this will be not curse, but malediction. Or you can say in Farsi, Urdu, or Gujarati, you can say baddua. It is a dua, but it's a baddua. It's a bad dua, not a good dua. And so let us be clear that sab and la'an are not the same thing. And this is where now, you know, I come to two very important questions about this issue of la'anat. Salawat pranay ikbarat. The first question is la'anat allowed in Islam? And the answer is very obvious. Yes, la'anat is allowed in Islam. I'll just give you four examples here from the Quran. I'm not even going to hadith or history here. Number one, there are 37 places in the Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala invokes la'anat. Number two, in chapter 5, ayat number 78, it talks about the prophets like Hazrat Dawood and Hazrat Isa ibn Maryam. May Allah be pleased with them and shower His blessings on them. That both of them actually invoke la'anat on the wrongdoers among their own community of Bani Israel. Number three, the Prophet of Islam himself, our Prophet, in chapter 3, ayat number 61, when he is commanded by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to do this mubahala with the Christians of Najran who had come to Medina, the ayat ends with the words that the Prophet is told to say to these Christians so that we may invoke the la'anat of Allah on those who are liars. And this is the meaning of mubahala. And so this is the Prophet of Islam. Number four, chapter 2, ayat 159, chapter 2, ayat number 161, chapter 3, ayat number 87, you will see the example where Allah and the angels and the people all together invoke the la'anat on certain groups of people. For example, those who knew the truth, but they hide the truth. And so that there are many, many ayahs like this. And so what we see here is that la'anat is part of the sunnah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was done by the prophets, including our prophet, and also by the mu'mineen, according to these three verses that I quoted the references earlier. So that is the first answer to the question whether it is allowed or not. It is the sunnah of Allah and anbiya and the mu'mineen. Then we come to this second important question. Who deserves the la'anat? The Quran describes the cases where la'anat is invoked for different types of people. Number one, shaitan. And I don't want to give the verses and the ayat for the sake of, you know, a shortage of time. Number one, shaitan. Number two, those kuffar and non-Muslims who are enemies of Islam and fighting against Muslims. Number three, there are 10 ayats where the issue of la'anat is on the Ahlul Kitab. Number four, the munafiqeen, the hypocrites. There are ayat where there is a la'anat for the hypocrites. Now these four categories are of non-Muslims. What about Muslims? Are we allowed to do la'anat on fellow Muslims? Interestingly, there are actually 5 to 6 cases where Muslim individuals can be cursed according to these ayat of Quran. Number one, for example, a Muslim husband who accuses his wife of adultery without any witnesses. This is in chapter 24, ayat 7. Number two, a person who falsely accuses a chaste woman of adultery and is not able to bring witnesses. Chapter 24, ayat 23. Third example, those who oppress others and do zulm on others. La'natullahi ala al-zalimeen. Three places in the Quran. Fourth example, a person who kills a mu'min intentionally. And I'll talk about this ayat later on. Number 5, a person who cuts off the ties with his relatives. Surah 47, ayah 22. Sixth example, a person who expresses hatred towards the Ahlul Bayt. And this is the ayat which we recited earlier after the khutbah, as well as in Surah 17, ayat 60, وَالشَّجَرَةُ الْمَلْعُونَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ. I'll come to this also later on. And the final category, a person who opposes the Ahlul Bayt or usurps their right and position, they are also worthy of the la'an, although they don't express hatred against the Ahlul Bayt. And so this is where I come to a very sensitive issue, especially in the last category here. Let's hear Salawat before I continue. Discretion in expression of the dislike and the bughz. Our maraji of the present days are clear on the issue of tawalla and tabarra, that these two elements are part of our faith. However, when it comes to the expression of tabarra and the dislike that we have for those who are against the Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt, they have advised two things to us. Number one, they say, refrain from sabb. Remember, we talked about sabb before. Refrain from abusive words, and that is not allowed at all. Number two, exercise discretion when it comes to expression of the la'anat. The Ziyarat of Ashura is actually a good example of these true advices which have been given by our maraji. It is a ziyarat given to us by our fifth imam, Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salatu wasalam, who was an eyewitness of the massacre of Karbala. The day of Ashura every year was the most emotional day for him. And those who were responsible for the massacre of Karbala surely deserved the la'anat and the deprivation of Allah's mercy. Yet the Imam uses two different styles of the la'anat in the ziyarat. And this is where we have to learn the lesson. Number one, there is a general form of la'anat where no names are mentioned. And you can go through your imaginations if you want. And then there is a second form, the second style, where specific la'anat with names has been mentioned. For example, when we talk about the general la'anat, you know, one of these statements in Ziyarat-e Ashura says, Allahumma la'an awwala zalimin zalama haqqa Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. O Allah, invoke your la'anat on the first oppressor of the haqq of Muhammad, the right of Muhammad and Ali Muhammad, wa akhir tabi'un lahu ala dhalik, and the last follower of that group. Allahumma la'ani al-isabat allati jahadat al-Husayn wa shay'at wa bay'at wa taba'at ala qatlih. And Allah, invoke your la'anat on the group which fought against Hussein, which, you know, supported one another against Hussein, which did bay'at on fighting Hussein, and those who followed the leaders in killing Hussein. Allahumma la'anuhum jami'a. O Allah, invoke your la'anat on all of them. So there are no names mentioned here, but it is a very general statement about those who hurt the Prophet and his Ahlul Bayt. Then we come to the specific form of la'anat in this Ziyarat-e Ashura from the fifth Imam. And there you will see the names of those who were directly involved in the murder of Imam Hussein alayhi salam. The name of Yazid is there as the ruler who ordered this. The name of Ubaidullah ibn Ziyad is there, his governor in Iraq, who basically, implemented this command. The name of Umar ibn Sa'd is there, the commander-in-chief of the Yazidi forces in Karbala. And the name of Shimr, the killer of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, is there. And Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salatu wasalam includes the families who were supportive of this plan to kill Imam Hussein alayhi salam. And when I say families here, I'm referring to Ali Abu Sufyan, Ali Ziyad, and Ali Marwan. And so this is where we see that in this Ziyarat-e Ashura, there are two formats of la'anat. There is discretion exercised in the general la'nat, where there are no names, but there is no discretion when it comes to the specific la'nat where names have been mentioned. And this is where I would like to say, what is the Shi'i point of view about Karbala? Karbala for us is the red line. There is no discretion and compromise here. Rather, we ask the Sunni brothers to clarify their stand on this issue. Either you are with Hussein or you are with Yazid. Neutrality in the matters of Karbala is not acceptable. And therefore we recite the common line in different ziyarat. لَعْنَ اللَّهُ أُمَّةً قَتَلَتْكَ. May the la'nat of Allah be on those who killed you, O Hussein. وَلَعْنَ اللَّهُ أُمَّةً ظَلَمَتْكَ. And the la'nat of Allah be on the people who oppressed you. وَلَعْنَ اللَّهُ أُمَّةً سَمِيَتْ بِذَلِكَ فَرَضِيَتْ بِهِ. And the la'nat of Allah be on the group who heard about the events of Karbala and were pleased with what was done to Hussein. And this is an ongoing statement which even applies to those who in Saudi Arabia or in the streets of Karachi are, you know, shouting slogans in favor of Yazid as Amir al-Mu'mineen. And on this issue, there can be no compromise when we talk about Karbala. Remember, there is no doubt that Hussein ibn Ali was killed in Karbala. There is no doubt that Yazid was responsible for it. And if you follow the Quran, remember the list of those who deserve the la'nat, a person who kills a mu'min intentionally. Look at this ayat now, I'm coming to that ayat. Chapter 4, ayat number 93. وَمَنْ يَقْتُلْ مُؤْمِنًا مُتَعَمِّدًا. Whoever kills an innocent believer, a mu'min, knowingly, فَجَزَاؤُهُ, his punishment would be جَهَنَّمْ خَالِدًا فِيهَا. Number one, he will go into hellfire, خَالِدًا فِيهَا, forever. Number two, غَضِبَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ, the wrath of Allah and the anger of Allah would be on him. And number three, وَلَعَنَهُ, and Allah will invoke his curse on that person. Now here we are talking about somebody who kills a mu'min without any justification. In Karbala, you are not only just talking about a simple mu'min, you are talking about Hussein, who is Sayyid al-Shabab Ahl al-Jannah, who is one of the two chiefs of the youths of paradise. Those who killed him, those who are responsible for it, they surely are in Jahannam. They will stay in there forever, and Allah's wrath and curse is upon them according to this ayat of Quran. So there can be no compromise on this issue when it comes to Yazid and those who are responsible for the massacre in Karbala. Tonight, let's hear the salawat, please. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. Tonight, I will just give you one quotation from a very prominent and senior theologian of the Sunni Muslims, Sa'aduddin al-Taftazani, in Sharh al-Aqaid al-Nafasiyya, quoted by Shajarat al-Zahab, where he says, وَقَالَ التَّفْتَزَانِ فِي شَرْحِ الْعَقَائِدِ النَّصَفِيَّةِ. تَفْتَزَانِ, سَعْدُدِّين تَفْتَزَانِ says, اتَّفَقُوا عَلَى جَوَازِ اللَّعْنِ عَلَى مَنْ قَتَلَ الْحُسَيْنِ أَوْ أَمَرَ بِهِ أَوْ أَجَازَهُ أَوْ رَضِيَ بِهِ. That the scholars are unified, unanimous, in the permission of doing la'n, in walking this baddua on the person who killed Hussein, or ordered it, or allowed it, or was pleased with it. وَالْحَقُّ عَنَّا رِضَى يَزِيد رَضِيَ يَزِيد بِقَتْلِ حُسَيْنِ وَاسْتَبْشَارِهِ بِذَلِكِ وَإِهَانَتِهِ أَهْلَ بَيْتِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ مما تواتر معنوه. He says the truth, the fact is that Yazid was pleased with killing of Hussein, and he expressed joy upon it, and he humiliated and disgraced the family of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And these matters are mimma tawatara ma'nahu. These matters are known. There might be single narrations here and there, but when you put it together, it is almost a unanimous, you know, reports. وَإِنْ كَانَ تَفْصِيلُهُ آهَاد قَالَ. And then he says, فَنَهْنُ لَا نَتَوَقَّفْ فِي شَأْنِهِ بَلْ فِي كُفْرِهِ وَإِيمَانِهِ. When it comes to his issue, we don't have any hesitation, even about his faith. And then he concludes by saying, لَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ. May the la'an of Allah be on him, وَعَلَى أَنصَارِهِ وَعَوَانِهِ, and those who helped him and those who supported him. This is a statement of a very senior theologian of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, known as Sa'duddin al-Taftazani. So our stand here is against Yazid and his supporters. This stand is not a sectarian issue. You know, some of our Shia speakers also are saying this is sectarian. This is not a sectarian issue. It is based on Quran and historical facts of as testified by Taftazani. Hussein is a holy figure for all Muslims. Do not they believe him to be a Sahabi, if nothing else? Do not they believe that he is the grandson of the Prophet? Do not they believe that he is Sayyid al-Shabab Ahl al-Jannah? Do not they believe that the Prophet said Hussein is from me and I am from Hussein? And this is where we have to challenge those Muslims and to get a very clear answer from them. Are you with Hussein or are you with Yazid? Unfortunately, someone made a comment recently about a phrase in Ziyarat-e Ashura on doing la'anat on Banu Umayyah by saying that it's a very, very faulty statement. وَلَعَنَ اللَّهُ بَنِي أُمَيَّ قَاطِبَةً. May Allah do la'anat on Banu Umayyah قَاطِبَةً means altogether. This fellow has made a comment. He says there is an objection. And his words are, isn't there one person who is good in the Umayyah? How can the Imam say without exception? I will just make two comments here. First of all, he seems to have forgotten that when a term is used in the general sense, then it has to be taken in the general sense, except when there is a confirmed evidence to curb its general usage and meaning and implication. So if there is a true mu'min, confirmed to be a true mu'min among Banu Umayyah, then that individual is excluded from this general la'anat. You know, this fellow who made this comment, he is trying to mislead the common people by ignoring this simple rule in Usul al-Fiqh, al-Aam wal-Khas. He should have at least remembered the words, مَا مِنْ عَامٍ إِلَّا قَدْ خُسْ, that there is not a general statement, but there is a room for exemption in it. So if it is confirmed that an individual from Banu Umayyah is a true mu'min, follower of the Prophet and the Ahlul Bayt, he is not part of this la'anat. Interestingly, the same Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salatu was salam, the same Imam who has given this ziyarat to us, had a mu'min companion from Banu Umayyah, and he is known as Sa'd al-Khair. And he actually asked Imam, in context of an ayat of Quran where he says, am I included in this la'anat? And Imam said, no, because you are with us, the Ahlul Bayt. When you are with us, then you are not part of that statement. And so Imam made it very clear. And now you have this fellow saying that, oh, this cannot be from Imam Muhammad al-Baqir alayhi salatu wasalam. The second comment that I have is that, you know, this fellow should read the phrase in chapter 17, verse 60 of the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالشَّجَرَةُ الْمَلْعُونَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ, the accursed tree in the Quran. Look at the extensive discussion of Allama Tabatabai on this verse in Al-Mizan. And you will come to realize that the accursed tree in the Quran is not a real tree here. It refers to the family tree. And according to many narrations that he also quotes from the Sunni sources, it refers to Banu Umayyah and especially Ali Marwan. And so my brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala considers Banu Umayyah as the accursed family in the Quran. And Imam Muhammad al-Baqir does the same in Ziyarat-e Āshūrā. In both places, this is the general statement. And if there is a mu'min person among them, then of course that person is exempted from that lanat. Salawat pranay ek parar. No Shia can have any soft corner in his heart for those who killed Imam Hussein alayhi salam. کیا ہم کربلا کے واقعات کو بھول سکتے ہیں؟ کیا عاشور کے دن کیا ہوا تھا؟ کیا حسین کے بچے، بنو حاشم کے بچے اور جو دوسرے بچے وہاں کربلا میں تھے امام حسین علیہ السلام کے ساتھ ان کی العطش کی آواز کو ہم بھول سکتے ہیں؟ کیا عاشور کے دن جو بزرگ تھے جو ایڈلٹس تھے جو جوان تھے جو نوجوان تھے کیا ان کی قربانیوں کو ہم بھول سکتے ہیں کیا ہم اصغر جو شیرخوار بچہ تھا اس کی شہادت کو بھول سکتے ہیں کیا حسین ابن علی کے لاش کی پامالی کو ہم بھول سکتے ہیں عزاداران حسین کیا اہل حرم کے سامان کو جب لوٹا گیا ہے اسے ہم بھول سکتے ہیں کیا زینب ام کلثوم اور فاطمہ بنت الحسین اور رباب اور جناب ام فروہ کی چادروں کو لوٹنا اسے ہم بھول سکتے ہیں بلکہ بی بی کے زینب کے کانوں سے بالیوں کو لوٹا جا رہا ہے ان مصائب کو ہم بھول نہیں سکتے ہیں اہل حرم کو کربلا سے کوفہ کوفہ سے شام ایک دربار سے دوسرے دربار میں ایک بازار سے دوسرے بازار میں قیدی بنا کے پیش کیا گیا ان کی تشریر ہوئی جس طرح سے ان کی نمائش کی گئی ہے کیا ان باتوں کو ہم لوگ بھول سکتے ہیں قطعا ہم نہیں بھول سکتے ہیں نہ امام سجاد بھولے تھے ان واقعات کو نہ انہوں نے اجازت دی ہے کسی بھی امام نے اجازت نہیں دی ہے کہ واقعہ کربلا کو کبھی مت بھولنا ہر امام نے قولی اور عملی طور پہ مثالیں قائم کی ہیں کہ کس طرح سے ہم کربلا کے واقعات کو یاد رکھیں آج ہم لوگ جمع ہوئے ہیں کس کو یاد کرنے کے لیے حسین کی وہ چہیتی بیٹی 4 سال کی سکینہ یا رقیہ جو بھی آپ نام دیں جو بابا کے سینے کے علاوہ کہیں اور اسے نیند نہیں آتی تھی شیخ عباس قمی نے نفس المحموم میں جو روایت لکھی ہے غالباً شیخ بہائی کے حوالے سے لکھتے ہیں کہ شام کے وقت اکثر جو ہے جناب سکینہ آسمان کو دیکھتی تھی پرندے جو ہیں ایک طرف چلے جا رہے ہیں کبھی کبھی اپنے پھوپھی سے پوچھتی تھی یا بہن سے پوچھتی تھی کہ یہ پرندے کہاں جا رہے ہیں تو خاتون یہ جواب دیتی تھی کہ یہ پرندے اپنے گھر جا رہے ہیں اس وقت سکینہ کہتی تھی لیکن ہائے ہم گھر کب جائیں گے ہم مدینہ کب جائیں گے عزاداران حسین اس روایات میں لکھا ہے کہ ایک رات کی بات ہے کہ جناب سکینہ جو ہے نیند سے اٹھتی ہیں اور رونا شروع کر دیتی ہیں جب ماں نے پوچھا ہے پھوپھی نے پوچھا ہے بیٹی کیا ہو گیا کہنے لگی میں نے عالم خواب میں بابا کو دیکھا تھا ابھی بابا آئے تھے اور مجھے پکار رہے تھے کہ سکینہ آ جاؤ اینا ابی الحسین اینا ابی الحسین میرے بابا کہاں ہیں عزاداران حسین رباب نے کوشش کی بیٹی کو سمجھانے کے لیے زینب نے کوشش کی فاطمہ بنت الحسین نے کوشش کی لیکن یہ یتیمہ جو ہے یہ خاموش نہ ہو سکی اس کے رونے کے کو دیکھ کر اہل حرم میں رقت طاری ہو جاتی ہے اور تمام بی بیوں نے رونا شروع کر دیا
دوران حسین جب سب کے رونے کی آواز جو ہے اس محل میں پھیلی ہے تو یزید کے کمرے تک آواز جاتی ہے اور جب اس نے پوچھا کہ کیا ہوا ہے بتایا گیا کہ حسین کی بیٹی نے بابا کو خواب میں دیکھا ہے اور رو رہی ہے بابا کے لیے وہ حکم دیتا ہے کہ حسین کے سر کو وہاں بھیج دیا جائے عزداران حسین کے سر کو ایک تشت میں رکھا گیا ایک بڑا رومال اس پر ڈالا گیا اور یہ سپاہی جو ہے قید خانے میں آتے ہیں اور اس تشت کو جناب سکینہ کے سامنے رکھ دیا جاتا ہے خداوندہ کسی یتیمہ کو وہ منظر نہ دکھانا جو سکینہ نے اس وقت دیکھا ہے جب دیکھتی ہے کہ یہ تشت لا کے رکھا گیا ہے رومال کو ہٹاتی ہے دیکھتی ہے کہ بابا کے سر سامنے ہے اس سر کو اٹھاتی ہے اپنے سینے سے لگاتی ہے بابا کی پیشانی کا بوسا دیا عزداران حسین اس کے بعد سکینہ کے بس چار جملے ہیں جو آخری جملے ہیں اس بچی کے زندگی کے بابا کے جب محاسن کو دیکھتی ہیں جب داڑھی کو دیکھتی ہیں جملہ کہتی ہے یا بتا من الذی خوابک بدماغ اے بابا آپ کے محاسن کو کس نے خون سے رنگین کر دیا ہے پھر ایک جملہ جب نظر جاتی ہے جب بابا کی گردن کی طرف جاتی ہے نظر کہتی ہے یا بتا من الذی قطع وریدک بابا آپ کی شیرہ کو کس نے کاٹ دیا اور اس کے بعد ایک جملہ کہتے ہیں یا بتا من الذی ایتمنی علی صغر سنی اے بابا کس نے مجھے اس کم سنی میں یتیمہ بنا دیا ہے اور آخری جملہ تھا یا بتا من للیتیمتی حتی تکبر اے بابا اس یتیمہ کے جوان ہوتے ہوئے کون اس کی کفالت کرے گا کون اس کے سر پر ہاتھ رکھے گا عزداران حسین سکینہ نے اپنے سر کو بابا کے سر کے پاس رکھا رونا شروع کر دیتی ہیں بیبیوں میں بھی ایک کورام بپا ہو گیا لیکن تھوڑی دیر کے بعد جب سکینہ کی آواز بند ہوئی زینب آگے بڑھتی ہے بچی کو ہلاتی ہے دیکھتی ہے کہ بچی اب دنیا میں نہ رہی جا کہ اپنے بابا سے مل چکی ہے
لعنة اللہ علی القوم الظالمین سیعلم الذین ظلموا ای منقلب ینقلبون خدا بندے اس قلیل بات قبول فرما ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے ہمارے توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما خدا بندہ جہاں بھی شیعان علی اور مسلمان جو صحیح معنوں میں مسلمان ہیں ان کو اپنے حفظ و امان میں رکھ سب کو اس کرونا وائرس کی مصیبت سے محفوظ رکھ خداوند شیعان علی خصوصاً جو مشکل حالات سے گزر رہے ہیں خصوصاً پاکستان میں ان کو اپنے حفظ و امان میں رکھ خصوصاً اربعین کے حوالے سے کچھ خطرات ہیں خداوند تمام تکفیری امکانات کو ختم کر دے اور امام زمانہ کے ظہور میں تعجیل فرما ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم ماتم حسین